further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
I'm Denise Dinsai, and here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. The Omicron variant reaches the U.S., South Korea, and the Middle East. The Philippines administered 7.6 million COVID-19 vaccine doses in the first 3 days of its massive immunization drive. And a sixth petition has been filed against the 2022 presidential bid of Ferdinand Marcos Jr. The World Health Organization expects to have more information on the Omicron variant within days. It says one possible scenario is it could be more transmissible than the dominant Delta variant. Omicron has been designated a variant of concern, but the WHO says it's not yet known if it makes people more ill.
So it's still very early days in terms of our understanding of this variant. And again, we're grateful for the information that's coming in daily. There's also a backlog of sequencing from cases that have occurred in the month of November, for example. So the timeline may change. The countries that will have detected this variant may change. And so I wouldn't put too much emphasis on exactly when and where yet. However, having said that, it was South Africa and Botswana that did report this to us and inform us. But as those sequences get sequenced, as that backlog is, they catch up with that backlog, the timeline itself may change.
The WHO also appeals for calm, saying existing vaccines will likely work against the new variant.
We know that it's people above 45 with underlying comorbidities who are at highest risk of developing severe disease after getting infection, whether it's Omicron or Delta or any of the variants. And we know that vaccines are likely to have some protection. We still need to find out if there's any loss of protection, but we think vaccines will still protect against severe disease as they have against the other variants.
The Omicron variant has been detected in dozens of countries, with South Korea, Saudi Arabia, and United Arab Emirates reporting their first cases. The global alarm further ratchets up as the U.S. detected its first known case of the Omicron variant in a fully vaccinated patient. Here's the full story.
So this is the first confirmed case of COVID-19 caused by the Omicron variant detected in the United States.
The first known U.S. Omicron case has been found in California, U.S. health officials announced on Wednesday. The patient, who was fully vaccinated but did not have a booster shot, has mild symptoms, according to Dr. Anthony Fauci, the top U.S. infectious disease official who briefed reporters at the White House.
The individual was a traveler who returned from South Africa on November the 22nd and tested positive on November the 29th. The individual is self-quarantining, and all close contacts have been contacted, and all close contacts thus far have tested negative.
For days, U.S. health officials have warned that the new variant, first detected in southern Africa and announced on November 25th, was likely already in the United States, as dozens of other countries also detected its presence.
The profile of the molecular profile of the kinds of mutations that you see would suggest, A, that it might be more transmissible and that it might elude some of the protection of vaccines. But we don't know that now. We don't know what the constellation of mutations are actually going to be. We have to be prepared that there's going to be a diminution in protection.
Fauci said it could take 2 weeks or more to gain insight into how easily the variant spreads from person to person, how severe it is, and whether it can bypass the protections provided by vaccines. President Joe Biden on Wednesday repeated that the new variant is a cause for concern, but not a cause for panic. Biden said earlier in the week the country would not go back into lockdowns and promised to lay out his strategy on Thursday for combating the pandemic over the winter.
The detection of the first Omicron case in the U.S. prompts President Joe Biden to extend existing mask mandates for travelers until March next year. A formal announcement is expected Thursday. The mandate was first extended to January 18th due to concerns over the Delta variant earlier this year. Mask requirements have been the source of friction in the U.S., especially aboard airlines. In some U.S. states, transportation hubs are among the only places where masks are still required. More countries are tightening border controls to keep the Omicron variant at bay. But for the United Nations, blanket travel bans could do more harm than good. More in this report.
Many countries, including the United States, France, and Japan, are putting in place tougher border controls and rules for air travelers to guard against the new coronavirus Omicron variant. The U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says all air travelers entering the country, including American citizens and foreign nationals, will have to show a negative COVID test performed within 1 day of departure. The World Health Organization said at least 56 countries were reportedly implementing travel measures as of November 28th. But the UN Health Agency is warning that, quote, blanket travel bans will not prevent the international spread, and they place a heavy burden on lives and livelihoods. So far, at least 24 countries may have reported cases of the variant, but some of the early indications were most cases were mild, with none severe, according to a WHO official.
Hope for the best, prepare for the worst.
That's what European Commission President Ursula von der Leyen told a news conference.
Vaccinate, boost.
She also emphasized the role of vaccines and urged EU member states to step up inoculation campaigns. Britain and the United States have also expanded their booster programs in response to the new variant. In South Africa, in the region where the variant was first reported a week ago, the National Institute for Communicable Diseases flagged a large number of COVID-19 admissions among infants aged under 2 as an area of concern. But an expert at the institute cautioned against linking that with Omicron just yet.
La décision est donc adoptée.
Meanwhile, the WHO agreed on Wednesday to launch negotiations on an international pact to prevent and control future pandemics. The agreement is hoping to cover issues from data sharing and genome sequencing of emerging viruses to equitable distribution of vaccines and drugs derived from research.
Philippine authorities are monitoring dozens of Filipinos who returned from red list countries. The government was able to track down 64 individuals who arrived in the country prior to the imposition of border controls. They are all undergoing mandatory 14-day quarantine. 3 of them are Filipino workers who returned from South Africa, the first country which reported the Omicron variant.
Based on reports, the 3 are fully vaccinated. They do not have any signs and symptoms. No results yet from the RT-PCR. We are still waiting and we are still monitoring. We are trying to coordinate also with the Bureau of Quarantine. And accordingly, Bureau of Quarantine already said that when they released the 3 individuals, that they were cleared by the Bureau of Quarantine. So extra measures are being done in Negros, wherein they were again isolated by the local government.
Health Undersecretary Vergere also says there's now a quicker turnaround time for genome sequencing, which is used to detect COVID variants.
We can already do immediate processing of this sequencing, and we can immediately issue out the results within 24 to 34 hours for about 50 samples. We have also our subnational laboratories and our satellite genome centers in Visayas and Mindanao and the other parts of the country, wherein we are already building their capacity, and by the start of January, they will start implementation already.
The Philippines extends its massive COVID-19 vaccination campaign until December 3rd after failing to meet its target. Latest data show 7.6 million individuals were inoculated from November 29 to December 1st. That's short of the 9 million target for the vaccination drive. Still, the health department says it is happy with the results and the extension of the program.
This is more than 2 times the daily vaccination rate. Hindi tayo mag-adjust. We will just get the final figures for the 3 days. Tapos yung extension parang bonus na lang yon. We should strive very hard. Kasi meron mga 21 million pa rin hindi nababakunahan all over the Philippines.
The Philippines will also begin administering booster shots for essential workers and the indigent population on Friday, December 3. Over a dozen schools in Metro Manila are set to join the pilot testing of limited face-to-face classes next week. The Education Department says 28 public schools in Metro Manila can start in-person classes on Monday, December 6th. Schools in the capital region have conducted dry runs in recent weeks to prepare for this reopening. Only Pateros will not participate in the dry run. 177 other public schools across the country were also added to the DepEd's list, many of which already began classroom instruction this week. A sixth petition to disqualify Ferdinand Marcos Jr. from the 2022 presidential race has been filed before the Commission on Elections. It was filed by members of Akbayan Party List and several other co-petitioners. Like in the previous disqualification cases, the latest legal challenge asserts Marcos is perpetually disqualified from holding any public office on the basis of his 1995 tax case conviction. A seventh petition is expected to be filed against Marcos today, this time by officers of his party, Partido Federal ng Pilipinas. But the Marcos camp is unfazed, saying it respects the right of every group to file such petitions. Davao City Mayor and Vice Presidential Candidate Sara Duterte Carpio sees a further consolidation of support after Senator Bongo dropped out of the 2022 race. She said since launching her vice presidential bid, she's been calling for unity among the supporters of her father's administration. She believes this would be more possible now with Go out of the picture. Go is President Duterte's preferred successor, but he dropped out of the presidential race earlier this week, leaving the administration without a candidate in next year's polls. The PDDS party is setting up a barricade outside the poll commission's office to prevent Senator Bongo from withdrawing his presidential bid. The party's executive director, Glenn Badon, said they have decided to make a stand and appeal to Go to not drop out of the race.
But as a party, we have our own obligation to make a stand also, because he is represented by the people. So the people makes our stand, and we want him to hear our stand, that we really believe that he is the right person who can continue the good things that they are doing with President Duterte. And we also believe that he has the capability to do it, to lead the country. That's why we have trust and confidence in him. We will help him to be courageous and make a courageous stand, because we are ready to be always at his back.
The Commission on Elections, meanwhile, says Senator Bongo has still not formally withdrawn his presidential candidacy. And until he does, his name will stay on the ballot. It's been 2 days since Go announced to the media that he was dropping out of the race.
I'd like to emphasize, no, that despite his public announcements, hindi pa po siya considered withdrawn. Kasi kailangan niya po mag-file ng personal withdrawal dito sa COMELEC mismo. And he has not done so, and wala namang indikasyon na pupunta siya ngayon.
COMELEC spokesperson James Jimenez, meanwhile, hailed Google Philippines for its decision to ban political advertisements for the 2022 polls.
Sa ngayon po, ang talagang inaalala natin ano, ay yung proliferation ng fake news or misleading information. Okay. Ano, nakikipag-usap naman tayo sa mga social media platforms, at meron naman tayong arrangement with them na mas mabilis nating ma-identify, ma-flag at ma-take down yung mga fake news na nakikita natin. Medyo masalimuot na lang yung proseso nila, no? But we have to do that.
But for an election lawyer, the decision of Google Philippines to close its platforms for election-related advertisements is an elitist move. Emil Marañon points out the internet is the cheapest advertising platform. He warns the tech giant's new policy may only favor rich candidates.
If ibaban mo sila lahat sa social media, then the others can still afford to go TV or radio, and we all know naman na mas malawak naman yung reach ng TV and radio compared mo sa internet. So mas lugi naman sila. That's the only platform that they can afford, and yung ibaban mo pa doon, so saan sila pupunta ngayon? Diba? Tapos meron ding restrictions sa in-person campaigning because you still have to get a permit from COMELEC. Mas lumiliit yung puwang or space for campaigning ng mga taong hindi makaka-afford ng TV and radio.
We're taking a quick break. Coming up, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development slashes its 2021 global growth forecast, warning the Omicron variant is threatening the economic recovery from the pandemic. More on that when we come back. Stay with ANC's Rundown. Wow, your glow!
I know the secret.
New Pond's Triple Glow Serum. 60 times better than vitamin C. Brighten, smoothen, hydrate for a triple action glow. New Pond Serum. Sa lahat ng bagay.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development warns the Omicron variant is threatening the global economic recovery from the pandemic. The group slashed its 2021 global forecast to 5.6%, slightly lower than its earlier estimate of 5.7% amid new developments on the COVID-19 front. But it retained its 4.5% forecast for 2022. The OECD now appeals for a swifter vaccination rollout, saying areas with low vaccination rates could create breeding grounds for deadlier virus mutations.
The global recovery continues to progress. GDP in most countries is now close to the pre-pandemic path. Massive fiscal and monetary policy support to households and firms from the outset of the crisis, the relatively rapid development of vaccines, the accelerating digital transformation in the wake of the pandemic have all helped get us into this position. But the growth momentum is slowing, and disparities in the recovery remain. We must continue to be vigilant in responding to any new infection outbreaks which can undermine the recovery both globally and regionally.
Aside from vaccine inequity, the OECD says inflation also remains a great risk to the global economic recovery from the pandemic. It also raised concerns about the rising trend in COVID-19 debt in governments around the world.
The G20 countries have spent $10 trillion supporting people and their economies since the beginning of the pandemic. It would only take $50 billion to ensure vaccination worldwide. The COVID crisis has increased debt levels, and as I've mentioned before, this was appropriate in the crisis. So the COVID debt is not the concern in itself, but rather the rising trend in debt over decades. And as the recovery progresses, the issue now is what are governments doing with this money?
A look now at the financial markets. The Philippine Stock Exchange regained some ground following Wednesday's bloodbath. The main index now back above the 7,000 level, adding 85 points or 1.2% thanks to bargain hunting. Regina Capital says many investors stayed away from countries with reported cases of the Omicron variant. As for the rest of Asia, markets are trading mixed as concerns over the Omicron variant continue to weigh on sentiment. In other news, Philippine authorities confirmed the death of a jailed former policeman who had been convicted for killing a woman and her son in 2020. Janelle Nuesca reportedly died on November 30th, but the Bureau of Corrections only reported it on Wednesday. It did not specify the cause of his death. The surviving son of Nuesca's victim wants confirmation if he is in fact dead.
Hindi po ako naniniwala. Kahit po sabihin na inga, may picture daw po, meron na pong nababalita na po sa, ano, sa TV. Ang reaction ko po talaga, hindi po rin po ako, kahit po si Papa, hindi rin po kasi naniniwala. Pwede naman po kasing nagpapwede ang death certificate, tsaka ano, o kaya palabasin na iba yung ano, palabasin na siya yung bangkay, pero yung iba yung ibang bangkay. Parang ganun po, police po siya. Mga maraming paraan para ano, mga makalaya siya, ganun.
Nuesca shot and killed his victims in Tarlac province as his daughter looked on. The shooting followed a heated argument over the use of a homemade cannon. Overseas, the teenage suspect in this year's deadliest school shooting in the U.S. has been charged with 4 counts of first-degree murder. Prosecutors also charged the 15-year-old with terrorism, assault with intent to murder, and possession of a firearm. He is being charged as an adult. The suspect opened fire at a high school in Michigan on Tuesday, killing 4 students and leaving 7 others wounded. One victim remains in critical condition. Switching gears now, local artist Juanito Maiquez, or better known as Quix, continues to be a trailblazer in the world of designer toys and visual arts. From recently winning the most prestigious awards in the toy designing industry to being the first Filipino to land a collaboration deal with sportswear giant Adidas, Quix is a pioneer, paving the way for local artists and graphic designers both here and abroad. Take a look at his flagship character toy design, Tech 63.
Yan yung itsura ni Tech 63. So kung makikita niya dito, Japanese super robot, naka hip hop siya, tapos mukha siyang graffiti artist.
Catch his full interview on the latest episode of Rev Plus, airing Thursday, 6 p.m. only on ANC. Before we go, ABS-CBN is calling for donations for Pantawid ng Pag-ibig campaign, where every 100 peso donation can feed a family in need during this COVID-19 pandemic. There are now more convenient ways to donate through our digital payment partners, Lazada and Shopee. Kindly prepare your mobile phone to donate via GCash. Just scan the QR code as seen on the screen. You can also donate through Paymaya and Cebuana Luillier. And finally, the following peso and dollar accounts remain open to receive donations. Let us all contribute what we can. Together, our help can feed more Filipino families in need. Thank you for your generosity, Kapamilya. And that's the rundown. I'm Denise Dinsai. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. More news comes your way at 3. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
Once upon a time,
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow